is Dan Orlovsky. That's Dan Orlovsky set to join us here. The ESPN football analyst who joins us on the program. Dan, who has the best chance to win, the Rams or the Chargers, in your opinion?
Oh, definitely the Rams. One, established coaching culture with McVay. Two, they've got an absolute superstar quarterback that's proven it year after year after year. I love Justin Herbert, but 1 year doesn't make me believe that you're going to be the same guy year after year. I think it takes 2 or 3 years to really figure out who you're going to be at that position in the NFL. I think that their offensive line has played together longer for the Rams than it has for the Chargers. I love the moves that the Chargers made up front, but that cohesion's got to come together. I think that they've got the best player in football that probably isn't a quarterback, or Travis Kelce and Aaron Donald and Ramsey, two of the best at least. So I would say the Rams, but the Chargers are no question about it coming.
The Zach Wilson showing up for camp now and the expectation level. What do you think the expectations are on Zach Wilson his rookie year?
Yeah, they're unrealistically high because everyone saw what some of the plays that he was a part of in college, some of those jaw-dropping moments, some of those throws where you just go, you're not supposed to be able to do that. If you had asked me that four months ago, my answer is a little bit different than it is now. Because of the tragedy that happened to Greg Knapp. And that's kind of the sad truth of the situation. He's walking into a relatively difficult situation right now. I mean, he's going into a room that does not have a guy on that quarterback room or in that quarterback room that has ever taken a snap in the NFL. Now, just because you have a veteran doesn't mean you're going to be great. But goodness, it helps. Imagine trying to learn how to ride a bike and no one can teach you how or no one can show you how. Because none of those kids have ever done it in the NFL. I think the second thing is his offensive coordinator, Matt LaFleur, the head coach of Green Bay, his brother, he's never called a play in the NFL. And while I love the scheme that he's bringing in, he's been around Kyle Shanahan for a while, calling plays is a completely different animal. I have been around a lot of really, really, really good coaches, super smart, great offensive minds, and they can't call plays because calling play is rhythm and it's art and it's feel. And then third thing is the loss of Greg Knapp. Greg Knapp was one of the best quarterback coaches in the NFL who had just a track record with young quarterbacks. And he's a guy who had experience calling plays in the NFL that I would imagine Mike LaFleur was going to lean on some. And to have those three pieces not in place, that's some obviously real life adversity with his passing, but also some just football adversity with Zach Wilson.
Who should trade for Deshaun Watson and when?
When is when you are 100% sure of what is going to happen with the off-the-field allegations. I don't think you can be 90%. I think you'd rather be late to this party than early because what the allegations are real stuff, right? And so I think you've got to be really confident in the information that you get, whether that's your own people and what's going to happen or word from the NFL. I think the teams that are attached to him are the two likeliest, whether it's Philadelphia or Miami. You know, both had the capital to do so going into next year's draft. Both have, you know, somewhat question marks at the quarterback position. I think Jalen Hurts is a guy that we've only seen get better over the last 4 years. We've watched him play football, whether it was at Bama, Oklahoma, or last year. And I love the kid, and I love his attitude. Will he continue to progress good enough to be a thrower? And then for Miami, this is a huge year for Tua.
Yeah.
Whether it's expedited or not, it's huge. I mean, they spent three picks on their offensive line in last year's draft. Those guys are going to be much better performance-wise this year. And then those skill position players, I mean, they got four guys that are good players, man. Five guys. Devontae Parker is a good player. Waddle is going to be an impactful guy. Will Fuller, when he's healthy, can go. And those two tight ends, Gesicki's phenomenal. And Hunter Long out of Boston College is a really, really good player. So I think they got some really good skill position guys. He has got to go and play really good football.
Talking to Dan Orlovsky of the Mothership, this Saturday there will be 11 hours of original live programming across ESPN and ABC. Dan will be part of NFL Live back together Saturday from 9 a.m. until noon Eastern. And you can see Dan with Laura Rutledge, Marcus Spears, Chris Mortensen, and Adam Schefter. We always love to give out grades or who won, who lost. How did the Packers do this week, Dan?
I think the Packers had a huge win. I mean, a week ago, it was like, it sounded like Aaron Rodgers is not coming. I was adamant, like, I don't think he's ever going to play for Green Bay again. And if you go back to the moment they selected Jordan Love, right, the moment they take Jordan Love and move up in the draft to take him, I would put myself into Brian Gutekunst, their general manager's shoes, and he would say, what's the ideal situation over the next 2 years? He would say, well, our football team's going to be really good. Aaron Rodgers will be our quarterback for at least two more years. He's going to play awesome football, and we can develop Jordan Love and still be a contender. Like, that would be the ideal utopia home run situation. Well, that's exactly where they are. And that's why I think, like, the fact that they got him to come back and they don't have to rush that quarterback on the field and he's still going to play high-level MVP football and they're still going to be in the conversation for the NFC title game and the Super Bowl, like, I just feel like that's an absolute home run for the Green Bay Packers. Now, what it means for February of 2022 and beyond, obviously there is going to be some, you know, very interesting conversations. But they got their ideal situation, their hopeful situation. And that's why I think Aaron, I think it's all, what did Aaron actually want? Because I've heard people say, well, he was just saying this because he wanted to try to get out after this season, or he really wanted to get out this season. Well, I guess we'll probably never know exactly what he wanted, truthfully. But I just feel like Aaron having to come back and still not exactly control what he can do after this season, you got to feel really good if you're the Packers fan that, you know, you got the best of both worlds, essentially.
Yeah, I think you got him. He's a one-and-doner. I also, you know, Vegas has Packers over under at 10 wins here, Dan. And they're playing in a suspect division, and they have to face the AFC North and the AFC West. Those are arguably the two toughest divisions we have in football. So.
Yeah.
I think, you know, you can have lofty goals if they're going to win 13 and go to the NFC title game. I wouldn't be so sure with that just because of the schedule that they're going to have to face. They may breeze through, you know, their conference. They may get tripped up by the Bears one time or maybe the Vikings. But AFC North and AFC West, that's tough sledding.
Yeah, Dan, I'll say two things. I think they're a championship roster. I really do. This is the same football team we watched win a ton of games the last years. I don't know if they're a championship team. Like, I just don't know what has transpired over the last 4 months. Well, I can sit here and say, like, yep, no doubt they're a championship team, because there is those things that you can't measure that matter. And this is a football team that has not focused on football over the last 4 months, at least in the forefront. While Tampa has, and Seattle has, and the Rams have, and Washington has, like, those teams have been locked in on football, and Green Bay hasn't. And I think their schedule is very difficult. I'd say two things that really I'll be focused on, because I think they'll be really good and they'll win a bunch of games, all that stuff. Like, is there a different sense of urgency by everybody? You know, like, will the coaches coach in certain situations differently because of we got one last year? Like, hey, fourth down, no. And I know I'm not just bringing this title game, that field goal opportunity, but, like, maybe even the regular season, they'll be more aggressive in certain situations because they know they have a smaller window. And then how often do they keep the main thing, and that's winning? You know, we've watched them bring Randall Cobb back, and Brian Gutekunst, their general manager, said, yeah, it was because, you know, Aaron wanted him back. Well, is that keeping the main thing? Like, how does it all work together? Because there might be decisions throughout the season or moments throughout the season where, like, do they do things or say things or make decisions based upon this might give us the best chance to keep him around after this year? Or does it give us the best chance to win? Sometimes those will align and sometimes they won't.
Yeah, it's tricky. You know, when the GM, we applaud Rodgers because of full transparency at his press conference. When the GM, Brian Gutekunst, has full transparency, basically saying, hey, I didn't want to bring in Randall Cobb, but we did it. We did it as a favor for Aaron. And then people are like, oh, I can't believe that he said that publicly. I just don't know how much is going to be too much in this situation for the front office to go, Aaron, what do you think?
Yeah. Yeah. I was around Matthew Stafford in Detroit when he was a little bit older, and they would always, like, I guess, get his input on certain situations and or certain people. how much they weighed it in different conversations, I don't know. But, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, the main thing is the main thing, right? And how I believe that's the case for Aaron. But different vantage points are different vantage points and how they view things differently. And I just – it's obviously a delicate balance that you've got to be very, very good at and very firm with, because general managers are paid to run teams and quarterbacks are paid to be the face of the organization. And that's multifaceted. And they haven't done that enough with Aaron, but you also don't want to give full power to any single individual.
Safe travels there, Dan. It's always great to talk to you. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Dan.
That's Dan Orlovsky, former NFL quarterback, ESPN football analyst, and NFL Live back together coming up this Saturday. That'll be noon Eastern, 9 to noon Eastern, with Laura Rutledge, your host, Marcus Spears, Chris Mortensen, and Adam Schefter.